Welcome to this message by Ray Steadman titled, Now Hear This, from raysteadman.org. The text for this message is from Jeremiah chapter 46 through 51.
Well, last week we left our hero Jeremiah sweltering in Egypt. Down in Egypt, an old man, having preached to the nation of Judah for 40 years, watched it crumble and slide morally and politically until it at last succumbed to the power of Babylon. And the city of Jerusalem was captured, the temple was burned, the king's house was destroyed, the king was captured, his eyes were put out, and the people led into captivity in Babylon. Except for a remnant that stayed in the land, and with this Jeremiah identified, and it too then apostatized and went down to Egypt. And there in Egypt, according to Jewish tradition, Jeremiah died, a martyr at the hands of his own countrymen. Now the book of Jeremiah closes with a section of messages addressed to the nations around Israel. And with this, we want to complete our study in the book of Jeremiah today. Remember when Jeremiah was called as a teenager, God said to him, I have set thee over the nations and given you power to build up and to break down. And now we see Jeremiah sending out messages to the various nations around Israel. There are three collections of messages to the nations such as this in the prophets. Isaiah has one, many of them addressed to the same nations as Jeremiah. Ezekiel has one, a collection of messages like this, and Jeremiah, of course. And all of these taken together comprise a tremendous amount of scripture, about 603 verses altogether, larger than many of the books of the New Testament. And yet I wonder how many here could pass an exam on any of these, what God has said to the nations through these great prophets. Well, Jeremiah's collection comes in chapters 46 through 51. He begins with Egypt, where he himself is at the time he made this collection, and ends far to the east in the land of Babylon across the Euphrates River. And once again, as we look at this section together, we see that truth comes at us in the scripture in several levels of understanding and application. That is, there's a historical, national, and political level of understanding this passage. These have to do with actual nations. God has said various things about these nations. Four of them, he says that they will endure throughout time, and that at the end of their history, God will restore their fortunes and bless these nations. And those nations are still existing today. In fact, have awakened from the dust of centuries and come to life again in these last few years, decades, time. And of two of these nations mentioned here, or cities, nothing is said of ultimate blessing, but they still remain today, though there's no blessing promised them. And of three of them, God specifically says they shall disappear from the face of the earth. And those nations have long since been lost to history. Now there's another level at which we can understand this truth. On the national level, these nations come or stay as God wills. But there's a level in which all these nations are addressed as referring to forces at work within us. We'll see that as we go through this account here this morning. These nine nations fall into three groups with extremely significant application to each of us. And that's the way we're going to look at them this morning. Let's begin with chapter 46, where we have Jeremiah's word to Egypt. It comes in two sections here, comprising two messages that he gave on two different occasions concerning the land of Egypt. It starts in chapter 46. The word of the Lord which came to Jeremiah the prophet concerning the nations, about Egypt, concerning the army of Pharaoh Necho, king of Egypt, which was by the river Euphrates at Carchemish, and which Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, defeated in the fourth year of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah. This takes us back, way back to the year 605 B.C., when Nebuchadnezzar first came up against Israel, Judah. And he was met by the armies of Egypt at the city of Carchemish on the Euphrates River. And there, one of the great strategic battles of all history was fought. And Babylon broke the power of Egypt at that place. Egypt had been the great nation of that day up to then. And here Jeremiah is describing in advance that battle. How long in advance, we don't know, but he describes in very vivid terms the advance of the Babylonian army and the clash of these conflicting forces and the great battle that ensued and final defeat of Egypt. We won't take time to read these, but you can read them yourself. It's very beautiful language. But in the midst of this is a characterization made of Egypt. And we don't want to miss that. You see, Egypt in the scriptures, as many of you already know, is a picture of the world and its influence upon us. Egypt is always the world. Egypt was a place of tyranny and bondage for the people of Israel. They were under the bondage of a wicked and severe king who made slaves of them, enslaved them, treated them cruelly. And yet, strangely enough, it was a place where they always remembered and wanted to go back to after they escaped from it. Because they remembered the food of Egypt and the comfort of Egypt and the ease of life in Egypt. And so it's always stood as a picture of the lure of the world to the believer. To think like it thinks and to react like it reacts. And to seek for your own satisfaction and pleasure and enjoyment instead of living for the glory of God. See, when I talk about the world, I'm not talking about people or doing any specific or so-called worldly thing. That isn't where worldliness is. Worldliness is an attitude of life, about life, that thinks of itself as living only for its own pleasure and enjoyment. That's worldliness. That's what Egypt stands for in the scripture. And you see this now described for us in this message on Egypt. In verse 7 and 8 is a character of Egypt. Who is this rising like the Nile, like rivers whose waters surge? Egypt rises like the Nile, like rivers whose waters surge. Every year, every springtime, the Nile River rises and floods and overflows its banks, and that restores Egypt. And the prophet uses that as a picture of the way the world comes at us. It just comes in surges and waves. We think we've got it licked once, and then pretty soon it'll come at us again. And repeatedly, again and again, throughout the lifetime of a believer on his spiritual pilgrimage, the world rises to afflict us and allure us and to seek to betray us and get us back into bondage again. But there's another message here about Egypt. From verse 13 on through to verse 24, you have another message delivered by Jeremiah after he'd gone down into exile in Egypt. And here he describes the forthcoming of invasion of Egypt by Nebuchadnezzar. When Nebuchadnezzar, after the death of Jeremiah, came down into Egypt in accordance with this prophecy and actually took over the land. And in the midst of it is another characterization of Egypt. It says in verse 17, "Call the name of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, Noisy one who lets the hour go by. Isn't that a strange name to give somebody? Noisy one who lets the hour go by. In other words, the noisy one who likes to kill time. And that's the characterization of Egypt and the world to us. That's one of the ways we can recognize the world. It loves noise. It doesn't want to stop and think. And it loves to kill time and is always seeking ways to pass the time. That's one of the characteristics of it. I clipped from an editorial from Christianity Today just this week. It said, picture, if you will, some solar ray suddenly causing all radios, cassette players, stereo sets, and televisions to stop working. Trembling hands impatiently twirl dials, adjust knobs, flip switches. Eyes are dilated with fear. Breathing comes in spasms. Marx was wrong. Religion isn't the opiate of modern man. Incessant sound is. We'll listen to anything to avoid silence. Long, pointless talk shows, boring conversations, round-the-clock news, and even rock and country music. We like sound because it blocks out the despairing cry of our own souls as well as the still small voice of God. But we need occasionally to take God's hand and journey into the fearful land of silence. It can be both painful and healing with the presence of the one who is able to still the despairing cry and give us a new song of thanks. Yes, that's the world, isn't it? Comes at us constantly, trying to get us to think in only in terms of immediate pleasure, indulgence, and forgetting that it leads to slavery and bondage. And so God punishes Egypt. That's the message here. And yet on the national level, as a strange word said in verse 26, I will deliver them, that is the Egyptians, into the hands of those who seek their life, into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and his officers. Afterward, Egypt shall be inhabited as in the days of old, says the Lord. That's undoubtedly a reference to the end times, when after the sleep of centuries, Egypt, which lost its national standing for centuries, has come to life again and is now a sovereign nation among the affairs of in the nations of the world. And so God promises to spare Egypt. And in a similar message in Isaiah 19, God even says that Egypt is going to be healed. And God will bless Egypt and call him his people in the last days. Now in chapter 47, you get a message of a nation very closely associated with Egypt. The Philistine nation. Remember your Bible stories about how the Philistines were always coming up against Israel? Goliath was one of the Philistine warriors whom David slew. These people lived on the southern coastline of the land of Palestine. In fact, the name Palestine comes from the word Philistine. And they were always the enemies of Israel. Many scholars feel that they originally came from Egypt and occupied Phoenicia and some of the coastline of Lebanon as we know it today. They were a type in the Bible always of the worldling who claims a place in the land of promise. That is a nominal Christian who is nevertheless the enemy of true faith. The Philistines were in the land, but they were the enemies of God. And this is a picture of those people who are nominal Christians, only who come among the church, in the churches, and yet really don't know God, and are really the enemy. And also a picture of those same attitudes in our own lives and hearts. That tendency to enjoy the blessings of God, but without any heart commitment. And Philistia is promised destruction. The word of the Lord that came to Jeremiah the prophet concerning the Philistines before Pharaoh smote Gaza. Thus says the Lord, behold, waters are rising out of the north, and shall become an overflowing torrent. They shall overflow the land and all that fills it, the city and those who dwell in it. Men shall cry out, and every inhabitant of the land shall wail at the noise of the stamping of the hoofs of his stallions, at the rushing of his chariots, at the rumbling of their wheels. The fathers look not back to their children, so feeble are their hands, because of the day that is coming to destroy all the Philistines. Here's the advance of the Babylonian army. And it meant the end of the nation of Philistines. For the Lord is destroying the Philistines, the remnant even of the coastland of Kaphtor. And so this nation perished, never to emerge again among the nations of the world as a sovereign people. Now, in chapter 48, we have another group of nations coming before. Egypt and Philistia represent the world in its enmity against us as believers. Now we have another group of five nations that represent something else. And the thing about them that links them all together is that all five of these nations are somehow related to Israel. The nations are Moab and Ammon and Edom and Damascus and Arabia, the Bedouin tribes that lived and centered in Damascus and Arabia. And as we'll see as we go through this account, they all were related in some way or other to Israel. Thus they picture for us what we call the flesh, that part of us that is us, that we're related to, can't get away from, and yet is the enemy of faith and the enemy of our lives, that inner enemy within. Moab and Ammon occupy all of 48 and the first six verses of chapter 49. We won't attempt to read all these, but here's a description of the downfall of these nations. Moab and Ammon, you remember, were the sons of Lot, the two sons of Lot by his own daughters, in that terrible story of the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah when Lot fled from the city and his daughters with him. Later they made him drunk, and then he conceived by them, and bore two sons. One was Moab and the younger was Ammon. And these men settled in the present land of Jordan, Moab to the east of the Dead Sea, and north of that the land of Ammon. And thus they comprise the present nation of Jordan on the east of Israel today. Now the character of these nations is given to us here in chapter 48. It opens with first Moab and a very vivid description of the cities of Moab as they're assaulted one by one by the advance of the armies of Babylon. Then in verse 11 it says, Moab has been at ease from his youth and is settled on his lees, that is, resting upon his rear end. Lees is much more polite. He has not been emptied from vessel to vessel, nor has he gone into exile, so his taste remains in him and his scent is not changed. One of the characteristics of Moab as a nation was that it was off the beaten track. Therefore, the conquerors who passed through this land from century after century left Moab alone. And it had never been assaulted. It hadn't been attacked. It hadn't been emptied from vessel to vessel, from conqueror to conqueror. as the prophet says here. It had never had its mouth gone dry with fear. That's what it means when he says his taste remains in him and his scent is not changed. That is, he'd never sweat with terror and thus changed his odor. But he had never known attack like this. So he was complacent and confident and proud and self-satisfied. And Moab, therefore, is a picture of the flesh in its confidence and its cockiness, its cocksureness. Everything goes well. Nothing's going to go wrong. And it pictures for us that attitude within us. But God says, therefore, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I shall send to him tilters who will tilt him and empty his vessels and break his jars in pieces. Then Moab shall be ashamed of Chemosh, that was their god, as the house of Israel was ashamed of Bethel, their confidence. Bethel was the place where the two golden calves were worshipped by Israel. And God's going to says he's going to disturb the confidence of Moab. He's going to tilt him up by the power of another nation here. The reason is given in verse 29 and on. We have heard of the pride of Moab. He's very proud of his loftiness, his pride, and his arrogance, and the haughtiness of his heart. I know his insolence, says the Lord. His boasts are false, and his deeds are false. You see, whenever you feel that way about yourself, it's Moab attacking you, just as Moab, the Moabites, constantly attacked Israel. And you're contending with this continual enemy of God, the arrogance and insolence of the flesh. But eventual judgment is to fall upon them, nevertheless, as a nation here. And finally, there's this promise in verse 47. Yet I will restore the fortunes of Moab in the latter days, says the Lord. That's why we have Jordan coming into formation as a nation in our own time. The fortunes of Moab again. Now connected with that is Ammon to the north. You know that the present capital of Jordan is named Amman, which is taken right from this. And therefore, typically, Ammon stands for the same as Moab does, only with one addition, that it's more aggressive, more warlike than Moab was. It's that which preys upon us, the insolence and arrogance that preys upon the spirit within us. And yet the promise to this nation, along with Moab, in verse 6, afterward I will restore the fortunes of the Ammonites, says the Lord. And as a people, therefore, as a nation, it still exists in the world. Now in verse 7 on, in this same chapter, on through verse 22, you have the prophecy against Edom. Edom, too, was related to Israel. Edom was occupied the land south of the Dead Sea. And its capital for many centuries was the city, the rock red city of Petra. Some of you have been there, that beautiful city carved out of red rock. And that was the capital of the land of Edom. Edom was a descendant of Esau. The Edomites descended from Esau, the brother of Jacob, twin brother of Jacob. And in Scripture, Esau is always a picture of the man of the flesh, especially as it opposes and is contrary to the Spirit. Jacob have I loved, God said. Esau have I hated. And in the book of Galatians, remember, Paul brings these two together. And he says it's the flesh who lusts against the Spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary one to the other. Now it's this nation that is addressed here. And God promises to completely eliminate this nation. Look at verse 8. Flee, turn back, dwell in the depths, O inhabitants of Dedan, for I will bring the calamity of Esau upon him, the time when I punish him. If grape gatherers came to you, would they not leave gleanings? If thieves came by night, would they not destroy only enough for themselves? But I have stripped Esau bare. I have uncovered his hiding places, and he's not able to conceal himself. His children are destroyed, and his brothers and his neighbors, and he is no more. And true to this word, the nation Edom passed from the stage of history long before the time of our Lord. It lost its national standing and disappeared in the dust of the centuries, never to emerge again. Now the last two nations in this group are given from verse 23 on, Damascus, and then verse 28 refers to Kedar, which is another name for Arabia. And the Bedouin tribes that inhabit the desert areas of what we now call Saudi Arabia today. Now, nothing is said of ultimate promise for these, but they are permitted to continue. And judgment is visited upon Damascus and then upon the Arabian nations. These were descended, as you know, from Ishmael, the half-brother of Isaac, son of Abraham, and thus they too are related to Israel. And the prophet describes in vivid language the destruction as the armies of Babylon come up to Damascus, how the famous city is forsaken, the joyful city. Therefore her young men shall fall in her squares, and all her soldiers shall be destroyed in that day. And then the Arabian tribes also are afflicted. Verse 29, their tents and their flocks shall be taken, their curtains and all their goods, their camels shall be borne away from them. And men shall cry to them, terror on every side. And thus these nations are judged by God. Now typically, these represent the restlessness of the flesh. These were nomads. These were Arabs who lived in tents and moved about from place to place, and they typify to us the restlessness of our natures and the power to upset and disarrange us that restlessness creates within us. And everywhere you go in Scripture, you'll find that wherever these nations appear, that's what they stand for. This is one of the great clues to understanding the Word of God, is that you're just seeing yourself when you read about all these nations, and understanding how they operate and work as you see it in the national life of these people. And thus the marks of the flesh are judged. Now the last two nations joined together, associated with Babylon, Elam and Babylon. Elam is given to us in the closing words of chapter 49, verse 34. And we're told a very significant thing about Elam. This time it was one of the provinces of Babylon, and yet it's singled out here by Jeremiah as meriting a certain word from God. And the reason is given in 34 and 35. The word of the Lord that came to Jeremiah the prophet concerning Elam in the beginning of the reign of Zedekiah, king of Judah. Thus says the Lord of hosts, behold, I will break the bow of Elam, the mainstay of their might. Now, Elam is described as characterized by a bow. And that, he says, is the mainstay of Elam. A bow, of course, is the symbol of the ability to strike at a distance, to injure and hurt at a distance. And typically, it stands for what Paul calls the fiery darts of the wicked one, who are hurled at us. These evil thoughts and imaginations that come unbidden into our hearts and minds, sometimes when we least expect them or least desire them, you kneel to pray and you're suddenly appalled at the evil thought that possesses your mind. What is that? It's one of these fiery darts of the wicked one. These doubts that come just when you are rejoicing in the blessing of God and enjoying Him, then some stupid, silly doubt will suddenly possess your heart, and you'll wonder whether you're really a Christian or not. What is that? That's Elam. Fiery darts of the wicked. The bow of Elam and his arrows that are the mainstay of this enemy of God. Ron Ritchie was just telling us this morning about how all week he's been struggling with the fiery darts of the wicked one. We can all sympathize with him. And yet God pronounces judgment upon this. Nevertheless, on the national level, notice verse 39, but in the latter days I will restore the fortunes of Elam, says the Lord. Elam today is the land of Iran, Persia, and has emerged again as a sovereign nation in our day, according with this word. Chapters 50 and 51, two of the longest chapters in the prophecy, are devoted to the destruction and overthrow of Babylon. Now, I hardly need to comment on what Babylon stands for. Everywhere in Scripture, it's a symbol of the great enemy of God, called in Revelation that old serpent, the devil. Especially as the devil uses false religious authority to claim earthly standing, prestige, and power. That's Babylonianism. Remember where Babylon began? In the Tower of Babel, back after the flood. Why did men erect the Tower of Babel? It says, in order that they might make a name for themselves. That's Babylonianism. The attempt to try to gain some prestige or status in the eyes of the world by the use of religious authority. That's Babylonianism. And you can see how that has infiltrated and permeated every religious group, every denomination, every church, every religion in the world seeks to do that. We struggle with Babylonianism right here. Anytime we long to be known around the world, to exercise particular prestige in our community, that's Babylonianism at work. And it has seized whole systems of religion so that these systems seek to gain great authority, to be known as princes and kings and powers in the world today. That's all began at Babylon and is characterized by it. Babel was where they erected a tower in order to ascend into the heavens and become like God. And under Nimrod, it became the mother of harlots and the abominations of the earth. That is, it began to export these ideas, the fountainhead of idolatry, all throughout the world. If you want to read this more fully, I suggest you read Alexander Hislop's book, The Two Babylons, tracing how these foul ideas began at Babylon and have been spread throughout the whole of the earth. Now the prophet predicts the historic overthrow of the city by the Medes and the Persians. Verse 2, declare among the nations and proclaim, set up a banner and proclaim, conceal it not and say, Babylon is taken. Baal, that is, the god Baal, is put to shame. Merodach, another name for Baal, Marduk, is dismayed. Her images are put to shame. Her idols are dismayed. For out of the north the nation has come up against her, which shall make her land a desolation, and none shall dwell in it. Both man and beast shall flee away. Just as Babylon itself was the great destructive power against Judah, so Babylon's turn has to come. And out of the north, out of the land of Persia, the Medes and the Persians will come against Babylon and overthrow this great kingdom. Despite its tremendous walls, its vast palaces, its ornate hanging gardens, its huge size and its great armies, the greatest power of the world of that day, yet God declares at the very height of its power that it shall be lost totally lost to sight, and even its sight would be, for a long time, be lost to men. It would be a desolation, and none shall dwell in it. In verse 4 and 5, you get the return of the Jews to the land of Judah. In those days and in that time, says the Lord, the people of Israel and the people of Judah shall come together, weeping as they come, and they shall seek the Lord their God. They shall ask the way to Zion with faces turned toward it, saying, Come, let us join ourselves to the Lord in an everlasting covenant which will never be forgotten. And thus they came back out of exile into the land. But Babylon's overthrow is going to be total. Look at verse 12. Your mother, that is the mother of all the harlotries of earth, your mother shall be utterly shamed, and she who bore you shall be disgraced. Lo, she shall be the last of the nations, a wilderness, a dry and desert. Because of the wrath of the Lord, she shall not be inhabited, but shall be an utter desolation. Everyone who passes by Babylon shall be appalled and hiss or whistle because of all her wounds. Look at verse 39. Therefore, wild beasts shall dwell with hyenas in Babylon, and ostriches shall dwell in her. She shall be peopled no more forever, nor inhabited for all generations. As when God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah and their neighbor cities, says the Lord, so no man shall dwell there, and no son of man shall sojourn in her. The book of Daniel tells us that King Belshazzar made a great feast, invited all the lords of Babylon to the city. They were reveling in drunkenness and debauchery when a hand came out and wrote on the wall. Remember that dramatic incident? And the king trembled. Daniel was called in to interpret it. And the interpretation was that that the kingdom that night would be taken from Babylon. That night, Darius the Mede led the army into Babylon, and the kingdom was overthrown. You have a reference to that in verse 43 here. The king of Babylon heard the report of them, and his hands fell helpless. Anguish seized him, pain as of a woman in travail. So the great city was overthrown, and it was so completely demolished that it was abandoned, and it fell into disuse, and the dust of the centuries covered it over. And for centuries, the actual site of this great city was lost. Men didn't even know where it was. It was only at the beginning of this 20th century that they began to unearth the site of Babylon. Once again, now these walls and the vestige of the city is beginning to come into the light of day again. But as God had said, it had become a desert and a desolate place. And the empty mounds beside the Euphrates River bore eloquent testimony to the truth of the Scriptures. But the city is overthrown. God says in verse 31, Behold, I am against you, O proud one, says the Lord God of hosts, for your day has come, a time when I will punish you. The proud one shall stumble and fall with none to raise him up. And I'll kindle a fire in his cities, and it'll devour all that is round about. There have been many who have said that Babylon must be built again. And you can read this sometimes in some of the books that are around today. Because of the prophecies in the book of Revelation that speak of Babylon there. But there, I think you need to note that it's called Mystery Babylon the Great there. That is, it's not the actual literal city, but that for which Babylon stands, the idolatrous practices and the blasphemous assumption of power by religious authority, that's what is going to be destroyed, as the book of Revelation said. And yet here, in verse 6 of chapter 51, you have a description of the overthrow of this actual city that is picked up and reported, used again in the book of Revelation. You see where John borrows these words. Flee from the midst of Babylon. Let every man save his life. Be not cut off in her punishment, for this is the time of the Lord's vengeance, the requital he is rendering her. Babylon was a golden cup in the Lord's hand, making all the earth drunken. The nations drank of her wine, therefore the nations went mad. Suddenly, Babylon has fallen and been broken. Wail for her, take balm for her pain. Perhaps she may be healed. And so the great city perished. But also, God has this word finally to say. Verse 59 of chapter 51. The word which Jeremiah the prophet commanded Sariah, the son of Neriah, son of Messiah, when he went with Zedekiah, king of Judah, to Babylon in the fourth year of his reign. Sariah was the quartermaster. That is, Sariah went as an ambassador from Judah down to Babylon in the fourth year of King Zedekiah. Jeremiah wrote in a book all the evil that should come upon Babylon. All these words that are written concerning Babylon. And Jeremiah said to Sariah, when you come to Babylon, see that you read all these words. The Babylonians heard this. And say, O Lord, thou hast said concerning this place that thou wilt cut it off, so that nothing shall dwell in it, neither man nor beast, and it shall be desolate forever. When you finish reading this book, bind a stone to it, cast it into the midst of the Euphrates, and say, thus shall Babylon sink, to rise no more, because of the evil that I am bringing upon her. And this is the end of the words of Jeremiah. The latter part of the next chapter is a historical summary that's appended by another hand, and just recounts the fall of Jerusalem and the ultimate restoration of King Jehoiakim in the city of Babylon. But here's the end of this great city that has attacked and destroyed God's people. What's the message of this great book for us? We've gone through this book now and watched this prophet in his struggles with the ways and workings of God. We've seen our own struggles reflected in them. What's the great message that abides from this book? Well, surely it's contained in these messages of the nation. Here are groups of nations that symbolize the enemies against us: the world, the flesh, and the devil. And God's word says that God is adequate for all of them. Faith in a living God can overcome the world, can beat back the deceitfulness of the flesh, and overcome the roaring lion-like qualities of the devil in our life, so that we can stand God's man, God's woman, free in the midst of the bondage of this age. Babylon shall sink and never rise again. And Paul, in the closing chapter of Romans, promises that God shall come and crush Satan under our feet. May that be our experience now in these days. That these are great forces and great powers bringing to pass all the terrible things that are recorded in our newspaper these days. But by faith, we can walk in the midst of them. That's God's message in the book of Jeremiah. Let's stand and we'll be dismissed in prayer. Thank you, Father, for the faithfulness of your word. Forgive us the many times we have doubted it to the point of acting upon our doubts instead of our faith. Deliver us from that. Teach us to stand, to be Jeremiah's, faithful to you in this day of declension and moral dissolution. Forgive us, Lord, of all the evil in our own lives and hearts. Help us to walk before you, knowing that you are tender and compassionate, forgiving and loving, able to make us to stand. In Jesus' name, amen.
Deepest corner of my soul, a rage. raging storm, stronger than I've ever known. All alone in the moaning of the wind, I hear you say, be still, my child, for you must know. I am the father of your heart. It is I who goes before you on this journey through the dark. Still, it's hard for me to see. Harder still to believe. Help me now to give you every part. Father of my heart, source of my devotion, save me from the storm of my emotion.
Face is all I seek for.
So